David, how's the gold medal going to feel around your neck?
Oh, that'll be great. Guys played excellent today. Really proud of them. Such joy for them. And what a hockey game. What an environment. The fans were amazing all game long. And so happy for our players. Country roads, take me home to the place.
Now, introducing, from the crab boats of Anchorage, Alaska, this last Frontier product made his way to Faribault, Minnesota, where he attended the prestigious Shattuck St. Mary's. A silky, smooth southpaw defender in his own right, was forced to trade in the jockstrap for a coaching whistle at the ripe age of 18. DC has held the position of head coach since 2018 at the University of Denver, capturing one national title to go along with one World Junior gold. Is that good, fella? One of the brightest young coaches in the game. Without further ado, folks, please welcome David DC Carl to the Live 5 podcast. DC, what's going on, baby?
Hey, how you doing, man? Thanks for having me on.
Yeah, no, we appreciate you for popping by. Obviously, it's the week before the Frozen Four, so we wanted to do a little bit of a special with you, obviously, going into St. Paul this week. How the fellas feeling? First off, at the top, it was a good weekend in Springfield. Obviously, you had to go out East D.C. and play UMass, Slamhurst, Cornell. You skated by both of those teams, but how was the experience out there? How was that regional out East coming from the Mile High City?
Yeah, it was good. Really proud of the guys. We had not played in a 2-1 hockey game all year. So to do it back-to-back nights and come out on top, like, really, you know, firm teams to play against, big, heavy. You know, I think it was a real challenge for us. Played Cornell a year ago. Did not come out on the right side of it. And so to get the opportunity to go back out there and kind of have a little redemption tour was great. UMass beat us in 2019 in the Frozen Four semifinal. None of these guys were on that team, but a team that we've played in the regular season the last few years. So teams that we knew well, knew it was a tough matchup. Really proud of the guys for digging in and kind of winning some games some different ways than maybe what we've done for the majority of the year. So Springfield itself, it was hotel was great. Crowds were good, and really happy to get out of there with two wins.
Yeah, I wanted to ask you how those crowds were, because I played there in the jungle back in the day, and the boys, the first time I ever rolled in there, I was playing for Bridgeport. They're like, Swish, you know what the best part about Springfield is? Is like when you leave the town. So I wanted to ask you in terms of how it was. They got the MGM Casino across the street. Were the crowds decent, though, in terms of just having some of those East Coast teams around, and you know, the boys were able to kind of feed off it, or was it a little bit dead in there?
No, I thought it was good, especially the UMass game and getting into overtime. I think one of the things that when you get into overtime in the first game, it's a single session ticket. So all the Cornell and Maine fans are coming in for their game, which I think helped fill the place up. And the best it looked or felt was certainly in the overtime periods, but not an easy ask to fill a building at 2 o'clock on a Thursday afternoon, even for the UMass fans 30 minutes away. But I thought they did a good job and created a good atmosphere. Was as good of an atmosphere as we've probably been in a while in the NCAA tournament. So it was good. The Cornell game, a little bit lighter, just with the UMass fans not wanting to partake, but that's all good. The rink itself, I thought it was good. The walk and to and from the rink was a little sketchy at times, but there was a lot of police around the area making us all feel safe.
Yeah, I mean, you guys kind of got the short end of the stick there, Coach, because you went in as the one seed, and it was basically supposed to be a home game for UMass. Like, do you guys ever feel like you're getting shafted by the committee there when they send you there as a one seed to play against a home team, basically, or is that just the luck of the draw?
Well, I think this year was pretty unique. You know, when you host, you have to be at your site, and so – I mean, it all started Saturday night. We of the NCHC final, we were the last game to finish. And so going into the third period, we knew that if we lost to Omaha, that UMass was out and CC was in. If we won, UMass was in and CC was out. And we knew that UMass had to be there. I think the committee was in a tough spot where, in a perfect world, BU goes there, but you can't play interconference matchups in the first round. So that shipped them out west, and it shipped us out east because of the circumstances. So I think it was a little bit luck of the draw on that regard. They only had one real move they could do, and I understand why they didn't do it. They could have put us in Sioux Falls with RIT. They could have put Michigan State out east against UMass, and then they could have put BU in St. Louis with Western. But when they look at the bracket integrity too, and the 116 matchup was BC Tech. The 215 was BU and RIT. The 314 was us and UMass. And then the 413 was State and Western. So it fit like bracket integrity. I don't think they wanted to take the two and make them play the 13 and Western and then give us the three, the 15. So I get how it all shook down. Not mad at the committee. I think certainly we can make the tournament better than it currently is, but I understand why the committee did what they did. I don't think they were like saying, hey, let's screw Denver and yeah. send them out east. I think it was an honest thing that came about, and we were good with it. Our guys never really, like I said, after the game bitched or moaned about it. We started the year in Fairbanks, and then the very next weekend we were out in Boston. So we're used to our travels, and certainly didn't use it as an excuse.
Yeah, it worked out. So
it did. Yeah.
DC, I wanted to ask you, you've been pretty vocal about this in terms of just having regionals being hosted by the top seeds. Is that something that you think the NCAA will eventually get to? I know obviously next year with conference tournament, the NCHC is going to go to the higher seeds hosting in terms of their own play. But is that something you could see the NCAA, and especially in hockey, getting to at some point?
I hope so. I think it would. I think it would really help the energy and the dramatics around the tournament. Not necessarily a tournament, because we do get great hockey. It was as good a hockey as we've had in the regionals this year. All the close games, overtime games. But I think it can lead to drama leading into the playoffs. If you created a home ice playoff race like we're all enthralled in with the NHL right now. I would love it. I think there's more momentum, gaining toward it right now than ever before. We've got 2 years left. We've got St. Louis and Vegas on the docket already selected. We're in a bid cycle to select out two more years right now. So we're probably looking at this system still for a minimum of four more years. But I think there certainly is some national conversation. We're hearing, out west, I think we've always kind of been in favor of it. The NCHC, the Big Ten. I think you're hearing more ECAC, Atlantic Hockey East coaches starting to get on board with it and want to at least have a conversation around how we can make it better. So we're thrilled that our league is going to campus site. Four out of six conferences will now determine their automatic qualifier from campus sites, which makes sense, the rewarding the top seeds with home ice. And obviously our hope would be that we can get that to the national tournament as well.
Yeah, I think that'd be really cool. And just in terms of, like you said, the full experience, almost make it like NHL playoffs where you have to earn that home ice, and logistically buildings would, they could work those things out. But DC, I wanted to ask you in terms of, you've had such good success, especially coming in to Denver. Obviously you were under the great Jimmy Montgomery, a guy I know a little bit, and just, even working with, coaches in Green Bay before that throughout the years. Like, what is one of your coaching philosophies, or how are you able to connect so well with the modern age player? Is it a little bit different, especially when you were coming up playing hockey? Like, just touch on that in terms of connecting with the young athlete now and how you've been able to kind of maneuver or massage that.
Yeah, I think I've been really fortunate from my time, even as a player, being able to be coached at Shattuck by gentleman not a lot of people know, but Rod Collins taught me a lot about the game offensively and about deception and different things that way. And then got the opportunity to play for Tom Ward for 2 years, who is an absolute legend at Shattuck and done amazing things and helped so many players. And then getting into coaching mentors, I had George Wozdecki here at Denver, Derek Lalonde in Green Bay, and then obviously Jim Montgomery here working under him at Denver as well. So, you know, I've been really fortunate to be around some great people in the game, and never forget that. And, you know, I think that's a huge part of what's molded me and allowed me to have a lot of success here in this role. So as far as like connecting to younger players and stuff like that, I don't know. People like to talk about my age and how they think that that's like the reason. I've always kind of said that I really don't think age has much of a factor into it. I think good people and good communicators and people who can connect, or you can do that at any age. And so I don't think like young coaches are better suited than like older coaches or anything like that. I just think it's trying to have an ability to connect with people. I got two, veterans on my staff, and Tavis McMillan and Dallas Ferguson. And I think they're excellent at what they do. Just because they're older they connect really well with our kids. And so I think that's like a human trait and a skill that can be had by anybody. Some things that I think make us successful here, I guess, would just probably be the way we do communicate. We're pretty open. We're pretty honest. We don't try and hide from things. And the players, I think, from that have a level of comfort and not wondering what's going on or what's happening. And that starts in the recruiting process and what we're looking for. And we try and identify people that we think will be really good fits and won't be good fits. And we're not afraid to move on from really good players that we don't think will be a good fit. So or not get involved in the recruiting process with people we don't think will be a good fit. So I think it's so much done on the front end in today's game and trying to make sure you get the right people in the room that obviously are also good hockey players.
Yeah, and sure. I just think Jimmy Montgomery, all the articles I read when, he basically gave his blessing and was like, hey, guys, you went to the University of Denver, like, DC is your guy. And you always come back to the point where you'd been coaching since you were 18 years old. So in coaching years, you had a lot of upper hand in terms of, the age you actually were. I think you got hired when you were 28 or so, but you had been coaching already for a decade. So it's like you got into coaching really early and you're able to, learn under a lot of different good mentors and good coaches in itself. But I just wanted to ask you, kind of transitioning into some of your players, this Zev, is it Bouyam? Is that how you pronounce it?
You got the last name right. Zev is Zev, the first name.
Okay.
Name, okay. By the way.
Yeah. This guy, I mean, talk about a silky smooth defender over here, DC. He's like what I like to call crispy rice. He's out there. He's snapping it tape to tape. It's a little sauce. It's basically doing whatever he wants out there. Is this a guy, this is a young athlete, this is a kid that's probably going to be, a top 15, top 10 pick? How much fun has he been able, just seeing him firsthand, seeing him grow? Like, for a freshman, he's putting up crazy numbers. I mean, this guy is probably the best defenseman in Denver history, at least a freshman since like your brother almost. Like, this guy, he's playing on another level.
Yeah, he's been real fun to coach. Great player, great person. We obviously, his older brother is on our team as well. So Shai's a junior. He's an 03 second round pick at Detroit. Really good player in his own right. And then Zeev's an 05. We had Shai in on a visit when he was going through the process, and Zev was Shai would have probably been 16 or 17, so Zeev's 13 or 14 at the time. And we offered Shai, and he was like, I need to take a day or two, think about it. Zeev's staring at him like, what are you doing? Like, you're committing, like, you're coming here. Zeev wanted to commit. Like, Zeev was hoping we'd offer him in the meeting, but at the time, not allowed to offer kids that young. And watching Zeev progress, grow, get bigger, better, stronger. Him and Shai have a great, brotherly competition, and they're competitive with each other. But Zeev has an uncanny ability to escape dangerous situations and make plays in and out of traffic and kind of almost bait people into it and get everyone on the ice where he wants them so he can make the play that he's looking to make. So been real fortunate to have him be here and be a pioneer. And you're right, his name will be called very early come this draft in Vegas.
For sure, it will.
DC, who are you comparing him to if you're showing him some tape or guys to kind of emulate or take different things from their game? Is, you know, obviously you're showing him probably highlights of, like, you know, Makar, what he can do on the blue line, or the way a guy like Quinn Hughes' escapability out of a corner, how he can, you know, turn on a dime, silhouette turns. Who is, like, one guy you're like, you know, or is it a few different players in the National League? You're like, hey, fella, you know, watch what this guy does in terms of how he breaks the puck out, or how he gets his feet going, or is he able to scan the ice? Like, who are you showing him some game film of?
Yeah, it's we get that question a lot, actually, from, like, NHL scouts, who's just, you know, they love comparables, and
yes,
who's this comparable, who do you relate him to? And Tavis McMillan did it for 8-9 years with the Winnipeg Jets and Atlanta Thrashers organization, so, you know, he's watched a lot of hockey in his day, and even he's like, honestly, there's not, we don't know anyone that is like him. I mean, I think it's easy to say Quinn, or, you know, Quinn Hughes or Cale Makar, but that's, you don't want to be saying, I mean, those guys are, they're doing unbelievable things. That's a, right. I think you're trying to pull pieces, like you said, but Zeev's an excellent player in his own right, has a lot to do to get to those guys level. But, you know, we even asked Zeev, who do you say? And he really struggles with it because he is such a unique player. And
just says Zeev. Yeah. I compare myself to Zeev.
He's very confident in his own skin and wanting to be his own player and own man. So it's kind of cool and unique that way. And he is a very, very unique player, certainly at this level.
Yeah, that's funny. Hey, just check the name bar on the back, fella. That's what I compare myself to. Okay.
Yeah. But William.
Yeah. DC, I wanted to ask you, it was always just a little bit of a weird week in terms of where you play that regional, you come off such a high, you get an OT win, then obviously you get past Cornell and you get that W, send the boys into St. Paul, the old Frozen Four, but you had that week in between. So as a coaching staff, before the year starts, are you kind of planning out, hey, like, if we get to this point, this is what our work week's going to look like? Or is it kind of just like after the game, you win that on Saturday or Sunday, you're like, okay, now we have the schedule, what we're going to do, we're going to kind of treat it with like an off week, but also implement some different things so we're prepared going into St. Paul next week?
Yeah, I think every year is different. You know, we don't plan like that, to that minutia, that far in advance. You know, so we look back, you know, coming into this week, we look back at what we did in 22 to try and just get a sense and a feel of what we did for workload and days off and rest recovery. But every team is so different. That team was, you know, for the most part, real healthy. We're dealing with probably a little bit more injury and banged up stuff this year. So we've leaned more on kind of the rest and reset the first part of the week here. And, kind of let them have some of their space and take care of their bodies. And, you know, even we've been on the ice Wednesday and Thursday, we'll skate Friday and Saturday as well. But, you know, it's not to the same level as what a, you know, kind of a regular practice week would be. So every year is a little bit different just based on team needs. And that even goes into the approach into playoffs. I mean, a year ago we were sick, we were injured, and we never really got the opportunity to talk and about playoff hockey and what was needed and what was required, like we did in 22 and like we did this year. So your approach year in, year out, I think it can't be, you know, rigid and hard, fast rules. It's trying to, you know, be adaptable to what you feel the team needs. And that's talking to leadership group and talking to our strength coach, athletic trainers, and trying to get a good feel of really what the guys need, because at this time of year, it has nothing to do with us as coaches. It's all about the guys, and they're the ones driving the bus. And it's our job really to just try and make sure that they have the tools, resources, and feel as confident and as good as they can physically and mentally to go out and perform. You know, so that's our approach. And I think our leadership group's done a great job this year with all that. And we're looking forward to getting going on Thursday.
DC, I wanted to ask, like, I remember being at North Dakota, and I know it's different for players. We had our own rivalries with other teams. And I remember at North Dakota, the coaches would try to get us all up for Omaha because they hated, you know, they had that rivalry with Blazer. And it's like, we can't get up for this game as much as you guys can. Do you have any rivalries like that where it kind of might mean more to the coaches than the players and you'd have to try to get them fired up? Or is it just more so fan-based and just team-based per year?
Yeah, I think it. That's a great question. I feel like it's probably in line, like players to coaches, more program to program. You know, I think our – and it all comes down to who are you seeing in the biggest games of the year.
For sure.
So, obviously, you know, North Dakota, we've seen North Dakota a lot in the last 20 years. Our fan bases, our players, our alumni – and so we know that those are always going to be big games. CC, just because of proximity, you know, they're obviously doing a great job, as we knew they would, getting their rebuild really going and firing on all cylinders. And I would say, you know, Duluth and St. Cloud, again, teams that we've seen, you know, in the playoffs, more Duluth probably than St. Cloud. We have not crossed paths with them very much, like in the NCAA tournament, although they've made it a lot, and so have we. But Duluth, we've certainly played in real meaningful games. And within all those, though, I think there's, you know, at the end of the day, there's a healthy respect. And I think that's what makes our league great, is we all understand that we're pushing each other so that we can be best prepared for the NCAA tournament. And it sucked to see Omaha Western and North Dakota all have leads in the third period. We're looking at like a really good first round going 4-0 or maybe 3-1. You know, being that last year none of us made it to the Frozen Four, there's nothing we love more than having, you know, two or three teams at the Frozen Four or three or four teams making it past the first round. So for as much as the rivalry's there, I think that's one of the unique things that makes our league so special, is we do cheer for each other when we're not playing one another. We share information on non-conference opponents, and we're trying to help each other out as much as we can. But when the lights are on and it's NCHC play and we're going against each other, it's going to be great battles.
Did it suck seeing North Dakota lose DC? Or are you just putting on the politician face there? Are you giving a little selly after? Because that rivalry is big, brother, right? It's a big rivalry, but obviously Brad Berry, you're probably good friends with, competitors, but is it stinging, or is you just giving a little like, fucking rights, we're there and they're not there?
You know? Yeah, it's got to be a little bit.
No, I'm going to be honest. I wanted them to win. They played two great periods, and you got to also remember who they're playing.
Yes.
In Michigan. So, and what's at stake with that? With the
Suppose you don't want Michigan to get it on one.
Yeah, the title count and where we're at in that. So, no, I mean, we cheer for our league. We do. And that goes back to, I think, the beginning of our league. I mean, I remember, I think Monty kind of led the way in that. We lost to North Dakota in the Frozen Four to your team, Gage. And I think Monty was on Twitter the next day. You know, sharing how he was caring for North Dakota. And I remember losing in 2019 to UMass, and we shared all of our information. We were the first place we went was Duluth's locker room with their coaches, and shared all of our pre-scouts edits, everything, to try and help them as much as we could, to beat UMass on their transition to a short turnaround. So I do think, I mean, am I going to lie? Yeah, sure. There's a small part, but the bigger part is we're cheering for the league.
Yeah.
Through and through.
That's pretty cool. You just have that kind of that brotherhood within the conference. And
that is cool.
Obviously Monty is a good dude, and I didn't know that. So that's a cool story to kind of listen to. But DC, before we let you go, just going into, you know, this week at going into the Frozen Four here, you got BU. I know we were chatting a little bit before. You're going to hold your cards and you're close to your vest, but just looking at BU, obviously they have some good star power in terms of some younger players. It's going to be a good matchup for you, fella.
Yeah, I think it's going to be great hockey. Four top offenses, you know. I think it's the three of the four youngest teams. There's a ton of firepower, you know, on all four teams. And specifically to BU, obviously they, you know, every lot goes through Celebrini and Hudson, and but that's not all. They've got some really good players to complement and support them as well. So Jay's done a great job. 2 years, two Frozen Fours. Not sure that's been done since Hack was at North Dakota. Jay's got a little ways to go before he catches Hack's mark. Maybe like 6-7 in a row. But you know, they're well structured, good defensively. Have the firepower and the transition work to make you pay offensively. So I think it's going to be great hockey for all the fans watching, and we're looking forward to getting up there.
Yeah, and lastly, Ozzie, we got to know on here. DC was texting me the other day. He just wanted to know, you know, why did you choose Denver the first go around? You know, he said maybe he might, maybe to quote the man, I'm not going to say if he said it or not, but he said you might have had two titles instead of one if you would have stuck it out, bro.
Yeah, I know. I couldn't have, you know, I look back and I'm like, well, I couldn't have gone wrong, you know, like two pretty good choices at the time. But honestly, I went to, when I was a kid, I went to Denver. I was living in Grand Forks and I met with Gwaz and Killer Miller was the guy recruiting me. I loved Killer Miller. I was like,
yeah,
this guy offers me something. So Gwaz gave me like 7 days to, they offered me a full ride. Gwaz gave me 7 days. I obviously looked at, I went to the campus, visited everything. I was like, obviously this place is unbelievable. So I went back and I'm like, told all the other colleges, like, hey, Denver offered me, they gave me 7 days. If anyone else wants to step in, like, I'm willing to listen. And no one else kind of showed up and offered me anything, so it was a pretty easy decision at that point. I mean, it's like, how are you going to turn down a scholarship from Gwazdecki and Killer Miller at Denver University? You're just not going to do that. So I was pretty fired up to go there, man. And Gwaz kind of had like a contract dispute or something, and they kind of went separate ways. And at that time, you know, I had family in Grand Forks, my grandparents and my brothers were living there, so I kind of just wanted to play in front of them. It was nothing against Denver, honestly. It was just, you know, if Gwaz and Killer Miller weren't going to be there, I obviously I didn't know Monty at the time. Didn't know how that was going to turn out. Obviously, it turned out pretty damn good for the University of Denver. But no, I couldn't have gone wrong. I obviously look back. I was really good friends with Will Butcher. We were excited to go in. I liked Trevor Moore as well. And that was tough. That was tough making that decision. But yeah, I mean, couldn't have gone wrong with those two decisions. So
no, it worked out for you. It was a hell of a game in 2016. You guys had a great team.
Yeah, that was unreal.
You're an East Grand Forks guy too, Oz. I don't know, at the time you were ready to get stepping around the Cherry Creek Mall. Let's keep you at Columbia. Let's keep you at the JCPenney there. You know what I mean? You know,
a little too high end. There, then,
you know, you don't know what this designer stuff is. So yeah, exactly. So. No, DC, we want to thank you for coming on, brother. I cannot mention the Denver Pioneers without shouting out my good buddy, Joey LaLegia, a.k.a. Joey LaLegend, one of my favorite defensemen to ever watch at the University of Denver, just in college hockey in general. But, DC, I mean, you're going to be in the NHL in no time if you want, if that's the route you want to go. I love what you're doing. I'm a big fan over here. And, again, if North Dakota's not playing, I'm always rooting for you. So just know that, you know. You're a good dude. So thank you for coming on and joining the boys over here at Live and Five. We really appreciate it, Coach, and good luck in the Frozen Four, babe. You know who I'm pulling for. I got the Butter Golf little crimson on here, so I'll have to send you a couple of these.
Yeah, please do. Thanks, fellas. Appreciate having me on.
Yeah, thanks for making the time, Coach.
Yeah, thank you.
Thanks, Coach. Country roads, take me home.